A very good morning to you all. All right, do you feel the love in your heart? All right, we're getting there. Welcome to our worship service. Please know that whoever you are or wherever you are on life's journey, you are welcome here to worship and to serve and to be in community at the First Congregational Church of Sharon, Massachusetts. I want to thank our house band for their annual summer gig with us. Thank you very much. As you make music this morning for us and with us, and we are grateful. Just a few announcements. There is one meeting this week. The deacons will meet at 3 p.m. on Wednesday for their monthly meeting. We're also starting to look ahead for some events come September and October, and I'm just going to put two dates in your hearts. One is the possibility of a comedy show on September 15th. We're still working out all the details, but it's a Sunday evening. It's dinner and a comedy show. It's sort of supported and run and produced by Jeff McKinnon, who is Helen Sand's grandson, and I believe he has done this for the church before. We've had this idea. He had this idea, and so we're gonna work out the details. And then mark your calendar. Oktoberfest this year has to be early, but still in October. Not like in Germany in September. No, October. So first Saturday in October the 5th, we're gonna hold our third, by now annual, Oktoberfest. It will be, of course, a dinner again, and maybe we play a little trivia. Not necessarily about Germany, but a little trivia. So to have the entertainment portion of the evening play a game. And then starting September 1st is the last Sunday when we meet at 9:30. By September 8th, you get to sleep half an hour longer. And then come to worship at 10 a.m. or be on Facebook by 10 a.m. So hopefully our live stream is working this morning. We had Comcast come out and take a check. All right, people are giving the thumbs up. So we are live. And let's hope and trust it will continue to go smoothly. All right, are there any other announcements at this point in time? If not, my friends, then let us join together in our call to worship. The word of God came to Jonah. The word of God comes to us. Go, despite your fears, speak the truth of God. Love your neighbor and your enemy. Forgive as you have been forgiven. Receive grace upon grace, overflowing from the fullness of God. Our first hymn this morning is number 426, I've Got Peace Like a River. Let us rise.
Peace, love.
be seated. Will you please join me in our community prayer? God, you call us, and sometimes we duck under the table, hoping you didn't notice us when you walked into the room. You call us, and sometimes we grab a stapler and a stack of papers, trying to look too busy to be bothered at the moment. You call us, and sometimes we just say no. We know that we aren't expected to do everything, but we often forget that you call us to be ourselves in the places where your very self is what is most needed. So give us the grace to say yes to your call, even now, as we offer our silent confessions. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. Today is the third in our summer sermon series on humor and laughter in the Bible. And there is no better story. Maybe I should have reserved it for the end, but there is no better story than the story, the book of Jonah, to make a point. So I'm just going to read you the very first three verses of the book. And I'll sort of will, my sermon will be like a theater play of all the pieces as the story unfolds. Now the word of the Lord came to Jonah, son of Amittai, saying, "Go at once to Nineveh, the great city, and cry out against it, for their wickedness has come up before me." But Jonah set out to flee to Tarshish from the presence of the Lord. He went down to Joppa and found a ship going to Tarshish. So he paid his fare and went on board to go with them to Tarshish, away from the presence of the Lord. Here ends this morning's scripture reading, which I know is just a little snippet of the whole story. The book of Jonah could be called God's little comedy. It pokes fun at our human foibles, and it has a happy ending. Frederick Buchner said that a tragedy is about the inevitable, but a comedy is about the unforeseeable. Jonah is full of the unforeseeable. Sometimes we learn a lot from the other end of someone's sort of funny and a little crazy story. But hopefully learning to laugh at ourselves is no small virtue. And such is why the Bible, while the Bible contains the tragic, it is not a tragedy, right? God is a God of the unforeseeable. Behold, I'm doing a new thing, says the Lord. Jonah was what we could call an anti-prophet or an unprophet. He was a man with a very negative disposition. As I was reading up on him, it felt like he is the Debbie Downer of Holy Scripture. And he didn't like people very much. So, how did this misanthropic prophet named Jonah wind up helping God to save a foreign nation that he, Jonah, hated? We shall see in this delicious little comedy called Jonah. Act One, The Call. The tale begins with God's call to Jonah. Arise, go to Nineveh and cry out against it. Tell them their wickedness has come before me. Jonah was dumbfounded. Nineveh? The very name brought up fear and revulsion to the ancient Hebrew heart. Capital of the dreaded world power Assyria, Nineveh personified all that was evil: opposition to Yahweh, military threat against Israel, a reputation for sin, cruelty, and ruthless power. Jonah could not believe that God wanted him to go there to preach. They deserved no mission of mercy. They would not repent, and if they did, it would be a ruse. Me? Preach your word there? Said Jonah, his voice cracking with incredulity. Talk about pearls before the swine. No way, Yahweh. Our prejudices rise up from deep within us. They attach our fears and disgust to other people, groups, nations, races. It is learned at parents' knees, reinforced by culture and tragically blessed by oh too many pulpits. In wartime, people are demonized and dehumanized. So what did Jonah do when asked to preach to a nation he loathed? A prophet is supposed to stand before the presence of the Lord, right? Jonah fled the presence of the Lord. God said, go east, and Jonah went west to Tarshish, a faraway place where he could disappear and forget, and hopefully God would forget about him, like Margarita will. He brought a ticket and headed to Tarshish, whose name sounds how one would talk after one too many margaritas. Our Tarshish might not be that far away. It might be just the backyard lounger, a few martinis, a TV and a remote control, the mall. We can flee the presence of the Lord in many ways. Act Two, The Ship. Jonah bought a ticket and headed west. A storm arose. The sailors were frightened for their lives. Meanwhile, Jonah was sound asleep in the belly of the ship. The sailors woke him up and asked him to pray to his God. They had already prayed to theirs. When the prayers didn't work, they resorted to magic. They cast lots to see whose fault the storm was. When things go wrong, it is good to find a scapegoat. The lot fell on hapless Jonah. "Who are you?" they asked. "Well, I'm a Hebrew," he replied. "I worship Yahweh, who controls the land and the sea. It's all my fault. Throw me overboard." Was this a gallantry on his part, an effort to save them, or was it the act of a man wallowing in despair? The sailors obliged and threw him overboard. Suddenly the sea calmed, and the sailors converted to Yahweh on the spot. Jonah, the evangelist, despite himself. It doesn't say whether the sailors, amid their praise of Yahweh, had another thought about Jonah, now on his way to the bottom of the sea. Act 3, the fish. There is a delightful rabbinic tale about this scene. The sailors repeatedly throw Jonah overboard. Over he goes, the sea calms. They fish him back on board, the storm starts again. They throw him back in the sea calms. They bring him back on board, and the storm starts again. Over and over until the great fish ends this foolishness and gobbles him up. Enough already? Act 3 happens inside the whale's belly. Actually, the text does not say whale. It says da gadol, which means great fish, species undetermined. Now, this part of the story has been subjected to great scrutiny by fundamentalists and liberals alike. In his novel Moby Dick, Melville satirized the debate mercilessly. One explanation: Jonah found a hollow tooth inside the whale and hid there. Just think, if the whale had practiced good dental hygiene, Jonah would have perished. Another explanation: Jonah hid in the decaying carcass of a dead whale for 3 days. Well, there's an appetizing thought just before coffee hour. The third explanation: Jonah was picked up by a ship named the whale. Some liberals try to prove a non-miraculous explanation. Fundamentalists say, if you don't believe this way it says it happened, you're calling God a liar, and Jesus too, since he mentioned the story himself. And God rolls her eyes. The point is not the chemical composition of the digestive juices in the belly of the whale. The point is the drama going on inside Jonah, and the drama inside God, as God tries to save both Jonah and Nineveh. Here the crux is the part of the story. Jonah, who could not believe God would love Nineveh, would rather die than live in such a world as that. And God, who loves both Jonah and Nineveh, would not let Jonah so easily consign himself to the depth, to the deep of the sea and death. So we really see God's redemption at work. God sends a great fish to catch Jonah's descent and haul him back to life. The fish was not God's punishment, but God's instrument of salvation. The monster, an angel of the deep. Sometimes God is there in the dark, in the belly of one kind of whale or another, and what looks like damnation leads the way to salvation, and monsters turn out to be angels. Act 4, the sermon. 3 days later, the fish spat Jonah on shore, which goes to show, as someone quipped, You can't keep a good man down. But he wasn't yet a good man. What's often missed in the story is how little change was there in this newly regurgitated prophet. The fish has changed his destination, but not his disposition. His geography, but not his theology. So Jonah went to Nineveh to preach God's message, not happily, but grudgingly, not really hoping Nineveh would repent and be saved, but hoping they wouldn't. Jonah's message is quipped the shortest sermon in the Bible. It is captured by five Hebrew words, and they go like this: 40 days more, Nineveh's toast. You can picture Danny DeVito cast in the role of Jonah, waltzing down the streets, delivering his message of judgment, barely able to disguise his glee at the prospect of coming destruction. If Jonah had delivered the sermon in the classic 3 points format, the 3 points would have been: God is just, you are not, sayonara, bye-bye. Jonah preached his hell and brimstone sermon, didn't wait for an altar call, not even for one verse of just as I am. He laid the word on them, cleared out of town, sat on a nearby hill, and waited for God's firework to begin. Act 5. A city repents. And that's what happened. The unforeseeable happened. Repentance happened. Much to Jonah's dismay, all over the city of Nineveh, we see the miracle of turning from the king to the cattle. Everyone put on sackcloth and ashes, from the greatest to the least. Then there is this remarkable verse. When God saw what they did, how they turned from their evil ways, God repented of the evil which God said God would do, and God did not do it. God repented because they repented. God changed God's mind because they changed their hearts. That should boggle our imagination. God is not an unmoved mover, forever unchanging. The future is open with God. It is not fixed. What we do makes a difference to God and to the world around us. God is not a God of the inevitable, but of the unforeseeable. And if God has something to do with it, it will be unforeseeably good. Act 6, Jonah's fit. Jonah is not happy. He throws a fit. I knew you would do this, you softy. I've read the verse 100 times. Yahweh, a gracious God, merciful, slow to anger, and abounding in steadfast love, and repentest of evil. Jonah is interested in God's mercy and justice. God's mercy for me, God's justice for others. I hate God's enemies with perfect hatred, says the psalmist, and Jonah would have added, and why can't God do as much? Anne Lamott quotes a priest friend who says, you can safely assume you have created God in your own image when it turns out that God hates all the same people as you do. Let me read this one more time. I think that's a great sentence. You can safely assume you have created God in your own image when it turns out that God hates all the same people as you do. So Jonah beholds God's mercy to Nineveh and asks God to end his life. Jonah wants to write the end of his own story, but God has mercy in mind for Jonah too. Spiritual sanity is releasing the end of our story to God. It is giving the end of everybody's story to God. It is releasing all the verdicts and all the outcomes into better hands than ours. Maybe that is what forgiveness finally is, letting go of all the verdicts and outcomes, trusting all of it to God. Act 7, the question. There is one more scene, one more unforeseeable turn. As Jonah sits asking to die, God appoints a green leafy shade plant to grow up and protect Jonah from the blistering Middle Eastern sun. For Jonah, it was a sign of some elemental goodness in the world. But as the dawn came, God who appointed the plant to grow now appointed a worm to chew it. In the muscular language of the King James Version, it smote the gourd so that it withered. Jonah exploded. Cross-eyed with rage, God asked, "Do you do well to be angry?" Jonah answered, "Do I do well? I indeed do well. I am so angry I could die." God asks one more question, the last words of the book. "Jonah, you pity a little plant you did not make or tend or grow, which perished in the night. Can I not feel pity for a city of 120,000 people who cannot tell their right hand from their left? Not to mention the animals." It is the only book in the Bible that ends in a question. The whole book of Jonah asks us this: when are we like Jonah? What is your Nineveh? Where is your Tarshish? Can God not have mercy on his children wherever they are, even you, not to mention the animals? And how we answer may save our souls. Amen. as we share our joys and our concerns with each other, I want to give you some updates here. First of all, Nancy Walsh is recovering very nicely from hip surgery at her daughter's house. I talked with her this past week, and she's doing very well and feels a little spoiled. And I said, enjoy it. We're going to pray for Gail, who's going to have some day surgery tomorrow at Newton Wellesley. We'll keep you in our thoughts and prayers. Shirley Scarfield has moved yesterday to Copley Rehab in Stoughton. So now she can have visitors. I think she went right from, they kept her in the ICU, and now she can have visitors. And our good friend Louise Hall is in the hospital with a case which of Bell's palsy. I guess she has had it before. She's in good spirits. I just talked to Ron this morning. She's in good spirits. She's going to go through some tests today, and if everything goes well, she will go home tomorrow. But just to make sure it's not a stroke. It looks like a stroke, but it's not a stroke. So they are really fairly confident saying that it was not a stroke, but a case of Bell's palsy. Are there any other people at this point in our midst we would like to lift up? Good. You know the ones that are in your hearts that need our prayers. Let us pray. O Lord, we lift up our souls to you. We trust in you because you are always faithful to your covenant. Your love for all people is bigger than we can ever imagine. You care about all people, no matter who they are or what they have done. So this morning, Holy One, we are doing our part, praying for the people, not just in our hearts who are in need, but everyone. Particular, we pray for those who are sick, for those who suffer or struggle. And especially we pray for those who are lonely or hopeless. We pray for those we have lifted up by name, for Gail and Shirley, Louise and Nancy, and all the ones that are on our prayer list. Holy One, we put our hope in you. Teach us to serve you, loving God, and make us faithful to your call. Open our hearts and minds to know your truth and shape our actions to live into your covenant. Hold us gently in your eternal mercy and set us free from all that holds us back from loving this world with its people unconditionally. And let us look around only with your love in our hearts. This morning, O God, we dedicate our effort, skill, and interest to your work in this congregation and everywhere we go. Let our lives show your good news to the world, O Lord. Let us feed, serve, and lift up your people in need. Bind us to each other as your beloved people, called together in Jesus' name. We pray together as he taught us, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. Even when we go our own ways, God is never far, always gently calling us back, opening our hearts and our minds. Through our offering, we respond to God's saving grace and love for us. We will now receive our morning offering. Let us pray together. God of new life, remind us always that our faith is giving and forgiving. Inspire us to expand our faith through reconciling deeds and expand it through generous offerings. May these gifts, we pray, as a sign of our desire to serve well, in the name of Jesus Christ. Amen. Thank you. All right, I'm going to get out of the way to make room for the band. We'll sing our closing hymn, number 467, I'm going to live so God can use me.
Thank you.
All right, friends, please be seated for the blessing and the postlude. As we go out into the world, may the love of God be the passion in your heart. May the joy of God be your strength when times are hard. May the presence of God be a peace that overflows within us. And may the word of God put in a seed that we might sow. And so may the love of God, the peace of Christ, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you now and always. Amen. Amen. Much job well done. Thank you everyone for being here. Thank you for watching on Facebook Live. Please join us for coffee hour in our fellowship hall. Have a good Sunday.